Failure to grab just any implement meant you weren't likely to pull through a day. I saw how a young woman's nose was sawn away. She choked with blood, but nobody paid attention to her. Besides, everything depended on the team leader. The daily quota was enormous, 14 cubic meters of felled timber. The team leader may register your output or not. If not, a punishment cell was in store for you. The felling site was 15 kilometers away from the camp. On the way back, they arranged their own hallelujahs in the twilight. Tired and hungry, we were ordered to lie in the snow. Some yelled, others prayed, still others cried bitterly. As for the convicts, they would start hooting and whistling and using foul language. To stop it, the escort would launch the dogs on them.
Then there were the bitches. They were the team leader's squealers. They would beat prisoners and extract job quotas. They would beat you with whatever was in their hands. They killed and were never punished.
Men with frontline and prison experience headed the fight against the convicts serving the camp superiors. They knew how to take risks and believed in force.
At times, political prisoners, especially ex-POWs, joined thieves in fighting the bitches. Like Nazis, Dezimia and Geisha tortured and executed people, thereby fulfilling their superior's will. Servicemen ganged up in secret and used axes and crowbars to disarm Geisha. Humans would be too much a word for those beasts. There was a special machine to cut square blocks. Geisha was tied to a large block and was left to move slowly towards the rotating saws. He yelled, asking for mercy. He wanted to survive, to live, you see. But the saws cut him into pieces. Well, it was a severe punishment, but fair enough. The news of Stalin's death caught me at Batugichak camp. We worked and thought, has he already kicked the bucket? Guys in the zone said, not yet, but he will shortly. God be thanked. When he died, the mournful music was played and we all started embracing each other like on Easter. All without exception, regardless of nationality. The superiors didn't know what to do. They had no instructions in the event of Stalin's death. The zone donned red flags. But mournful ribbons were not to be seen. There were many immigrants from Harbin, from France, from Eastern Europe. They all raised Russian flags. The Lithuanians raised yellow, green, and red flags. The Ukrainians raised the yellow-black standard. People rejoiced, although the practices remained the same. The thaw in Kolyma went on and on.
Stalin's death was like a crack at the Gulag Foundation. The camps remained intact for quite a while. They were filled full all across the country. Some 2 million prisoners remained in the camps after amnesty, by official figures.
The convicts seemed more cheerful after Stalin's death.
The power had developed a crack. All rose to their full stature, determined to state their case. The ball was set rolling after a convict was wounded one day. No one in the zone would show up for work. It was a mutiny against Soviet power. The machine was no longer that tough. Our attitude towards it altered dramatically. We demanded that we not be locked in for the night, and no more bars on the barracks windows. We demanded free letter writing and pay for work. A few hours later, a duty officer was brought in. We refused to go to the barrack and shouted, "Get out, pirates!" I was standing out front, but all those behind me voiced their support. Shooting began. First overhead, and lower and lower, which is something I'm used to. I looked behind, and no one was there. It was decided to create an organized force, so as to hit, not with fanned fingers, but with a clenched fist, and hard. A party was to be created. We banded together and formed the Democratic Party of Russia. And then they scattered us through different camps. It was like dropping a box of matches. Everywhere we went, unrest and disobedience flared up. A wave of uprisings rolled all across Kolyma. There were people there who had gone through many lands and faced death a thousand times. The Lord selected them for the future. They defied bullets and the threat of execution. Shooting at them during escape attempts was useless, too. We managed to survive no matter what.
Sergei Dmitrievich Solovyov was set free only in 1979. He attempted many escapes and was given additional sentences, but made no compromise with the power. He's still waiting to be rehabilitated.
I'd flee any time, even with a couple days left on my sentence. My thirst for freedom was my moving force, my survival. I made flights from a truck, a train, the zone. I remember a joint getaway by four at Ustilim. They were shot down 15 minutes after they escaped. Significantly enough, all killed escapees lay for weeks in winter by the watchtower. I never stopped trying to escape. There were lots of flights, especially in 1953. Those weren't merely flights, but veritable uprisings. Weapons were seized in a bid to break away from the Union, but to flee from Kolyma was next to impossible. I would make an escape, first of all, that I might take a free breath. And every time I hoped against hope that this time I would be luckier than the last. Several times I attempted to put together a team of five or six in order to make sure they wouldn't eat each other. There were such cases during escapes. When attempting a getaway from the camp, there was a 99% chance he'd be shot down. When planning an escape, you'd always get food ready. Once there was a rainfall, and as a result, there was a big ditch. We had 3 minutes to decide whether to run or not. Without hesitation, we both jumped into the ditch. I found Siryoja, and then we dashed into the taiga. We went out onto the road, and we were short of foodstuffs. I never killed, but I needed something to eat. We were spotted, and we tried to flee, but pursuers with dogs overtook us. The dogs had gold teeth. It had gold teeth put in. They caught us after 3 days. There were three of us, and the guards fired point blank. I got three bullets in the back. Two of them were removed in 1973. The guards were so lazy, they carried us to the road post to be picked up later. Car drivers witnessed the shooting. The guards left us to go drinking. They were rewarded for killing escapees. Drivers came up to us. They noticed I was still showing signs of life. For 20 days, they took care of me, so I survived. I decided to write a complaint to the United Nations regarding our entire communist state. That was in the year 1955. So I wrote a statement of grievances from Vasilia Kovalev, a builder of communism, a political prisoner, and eternal slave. It took me 3 months to write the letter listing my problems. I wrote about freedom at large and captivity. I was taken to the Correctional Labor Camps Board. I said there, "Why are you afraid of me? I'm a downright wreck, only skin and eyes left." He said, "You signed your own death verdict, and we're not going to shoot you. We're going to let you rot alive for this complaint." Well, this bastard, I guess, must be still alive somewhere now. I was sent to the strict regimen zone, stone sack. This meant death. So I heard the outside door open, and a dog's breathing. I didn't think they would set it on me. But they let the dog through the doorway, and the beast jumped on me. It was heavier than me. I kicked it in the neck. The dog fell down and became quiet. In came 6 men and started busting me against the wall. I realized I was done for. Having come to, I saw feet sticking out from the corner. They belonged to someone on the floor. The man was dead and frozen to the wall. I couldn't rise. My arms and legs were smashed. For a month, I had to eat like a dog. They were real beasts, worse than Gestapo men. They were the communist Red Gestapo. Hatred for the Soviet communist regime was the only thing they couldn't wrest from me. They took my freedom and everything else except this hatred. I hated them with my eyes, my thoughts. I'll keep hating them even into the beyond.
To our brothers and sisters killed wantonly, now reposing in unmarked graves in the chilly Kolyma, may your memory live forever.
Of these times have been destroyed. The watchtowers sawn down, the barracks razed, the barbed wire rolled up and taken to some other place. Now flourishing on the camp's ruins is fireweed and neglect, the foe of archives and of human memory. Did we exist at all? I reply, we did. I have declared that for each inexorable moment. I declare it with full responsibility for this, our document.
In translation by Anatoly Antohin and Gwendolyn Womack. Voiceover by Daniel Kleinfeld, Liz Hilliard, Sven Holmberg, Brett Levy, and Oleg Kulikovich.